Go Racing, taco meter alert, 100% full alert, sirens, everything blaring. We are not going to do anything on this episode. This is purely talking about where we're at on this car, how we're going to go forward, things I would have done different, things I'm concerned about, like on our shakedown run, and that type of thing. So if that's not what you want, you just want to see me do stuff, just stop now. You're not going to like this episode, I promise you. So let's get going. We're going to start with interior, then we're going to move to the suspension stuff, the engine stuff, and then the body stuff on it. We're not going to work on them in those order. That's just the order that we're going to talk about it, because that's the order I chose, not because of any other reason. It's just the way that came out of my head. So anyway, let's get going on the interior. All right, last time. Interior. There's a lot to talk about, so it takes a little bit. Interior, we're going to start with door panel. Door panel, the top piece that has the radius on it, that's usually steel. I'm going to assume it's steel. Then the card stock that they do on the bottom, I'm going to draw that up and have it cut out laser, or probably water jet out of aluminum. And then we will probably use Raptor liner to spray it so it's simulated to vinyl, and then actually put vinyl on the steel part again like it is from the factory. So that's the plan with the door panels. That's all gonna happen after the shakedown run and stuff. That's a finishing touch thing, like a winter project more. The dashboard is going to stay exactly like you see it. I'm not gonna change a thing. I like it that way. I don't want it modified, moderned up, or anything that will just be outdated in 2 years. So that's gonna stay just like you see it. The only thing that will change is this steering wheel is going to have to go. Later on, we're gonna talk about bump steer and the risk of some bump steer and high speed driving in this car. And a large steering wheel with bump steer is not a good idea. And the bump steer, don't think too much into it. I may explain what I mean when we get to it. And then the gauges. So that gauge is a clock. That gauge is battery. That gauge is fuel. Those are all going to remain working the way they are, but we have no engine monitoring. Speedometer, we have a speed generator that will generate that, so that will continue working no matter what transmission we put in it. And then we're going to have to do some sort of a pillar. Gauge pod. I don't know what they make yet for LT Gen 5 stuff, but I'm hoping I can just do ODB2 tight style plug so that we're not running additional wires into our harness or converting some of the ports on those LS motors to pipe threads so that we can run analog gauges. I don't want to do any of that. I want to be able to plug in to the ODB2 and run a gauge engine monitoring somehow up on that pillar. So that's the plan for gauges. So there's the transfer case and transmission in it. That's getting two shifters. It's getting cup holders in the back. It's getting cup holders somewhere in the front that's usable for the driver. And then it's getting, maybe if there's room, which there may not be, some sort of a cup holder, or some sort of a console, just for tight stuff. As we're using the car and we pull in or whatever, and you want to just put your stuff in a console, that's what will be there. No more ribbon cable, that's going away. There's going to be a cable underneath the car. That we also have battery cable under the car, because the batteries are going to be in the back. We'll talk about that in a second. I'm building this thing. I've been calling it a safari rig, but in reality it should be called Outlander rig. Is that Outlander that they're calling them now? I started Googling that, and man, there's some cool rigs out there that are set up that way, because we're setting this up to be kind of like a survival rig in the safari, so I call it safari rig. Well, there's kind of like a class of rig that already fits into, and that's those uplanding style rigs, and that's basically what we're doing with this thing. So I should have been calling it that from the beginning. So the rear trunk pan, we're going to cut it out all the way just around the bottom part. And we are going to make our spare tire will fit in there. Our jack, spare parts, U-joints, all that type of stuff will all have its own homes in there, so they're not sliding around and doing all that stuff. Everything will be tied down. So that's where it'll be nice, because that's all heavy and it'll all be low center of gravity. So that's what's going to go back in there. So we're just going to cut that out and start basically from scratch. And then that's the factory spare tire area. Obviously our tire won't fit in the factory area, although it actually does look like it would be close, but I think it would be too wide is the problem. But we're gonna cut it off flat, and that's where our batteries will be situated. And then above the batteries, there'll be our other things like tools and all in its own designated spots, like tool bags and all that type of stuff. And then maybe like an inverter and our sound, our stereo. I forgot we are gonna put a sound system in the car, but we're not putting a head unit in the car. It's gonna be just Bluetooth, like a Marine style. It'll be operated via just like a tablet or whatever that we can just throw in the glove box. We're not modifying the car that way. So we'll have there's minimalist speakers on the inside, and then we're actually going to have some outdoor speakers that are removable from the outside of the car, so that for our camping situations. So that'll be really cool. All the surfaces that are upholstered like this, they're all metal. So we're gonna strip those off, and we're gonna Raptor liner those too, as well as all the floor and stuff. If I didn't mention that, the floor is all getting Raptor lined. There, that's an epoxy that we can spray ourselves. Anyway, so that's the inside. Rear window is power. We have to fix it. I don't know what's wrong with it. The motor was out of it when I got it, but the motor does spin when I put power to it. So I think we just need to wire it and put it back together. I'm pretty sure it's all that needs. Legacy soft top is going in the car. I almost forgot about that. So all the headliners coming down, there will be a small headliner basically going from here to here, just covering that area, and we'll just have that done when we're done. There'll be an aluminum frame here, and then the bottom of the soft top, when it's slid forward, will look very similar to that. And then when it's slid back, you'll be looking at whatever's above the car, because that's the whole point. And it's full width, full length. So it's going to be really, really, really cool, that part of it. I can't wait for the soft top. That's going to really, really make this car neat. We'll just jump into the body, even though I don't think that was next on my list, but we're gonna jump into the body. So there are some things we're gonna do to the body, not much though. The paint is not nearly as offensive as I was originally. I think I'm just getting used to it now, or maybe it's being dulled down by the dust. But when it was big and lived with wheels and tires and axles under it, it looked really cool to me. I actually was digging the color. So I think we're just gonna do some graphics onto it, some Death Toll stuff, Safari stuff, onto the body. Instead of wrapping it entirely, which was my original plan, but we do need to let Will do his magic on it, and he can make this thing look really cool from here. We'll just use this as his base color, and then he can do his stuff. And then if we get sick of it, that's what's cool. We can take it off, and he can do something else. Really cool. So that's the spare that we were talking about. How it's dented. That's supposed to be round, but it will just be flush with the bottom of the quarter panel. We're getting Raptor line. All from the chrome trim down. We'll take all the chrome trim off, we'll make a mask line, and all that from there down is going to be Raptor lined. And there are a couple spots we have to cut it out and repair the rust, but we don't have to do, I'm not gonna leave any rust in the car, but we don't have to do all the body work, so it's absolutely perfect, because you really won't see it once it's Raptor lined. And then we do have to make some sort of a rock slider for it that will go down the body of the car, and it'll be mounted off the frame of the car. So while I have this car up, when we're putting it back together, I am probably going to put pads on it in preparation, just so we have a point of which to mount a rock slider on this thing. So that is the outside there. I am going to, at some point, have this bumper re-chromed. And I am in the market for a new rear bumper for this. And I don't believe it even has to be a station wagon. Yeah, so the spoiler is coming off. That'll come off soon. And I think that's about it. The chrome, I originally was going to delete it, but I'm not. I'm going to leave it. I like it now. And I think it's all going to stay. Oh, the hood. We got a shaker hood that we lost during our engine swap. For now, if I can't find a hood right away, I'm just gonna bolt the shaker part to the hood somehow, and just mount it to it, so it's just part of the hood at that point. I don't know what else to do. I hate fake things like that. But it is what it is. I don't know what else to do with it on this car. The engine drivetrain and stuff like that. Regrets. I mean, I don't even need to mention that I regret going down the Pontiac Road for a little while. I obviously regret that. I would have been many steps ahead had I just done this from the beginning. So buying the engine, though, I do have some regrets on this engine, a little bit. I didn't need to buy such a complete engine. I ended up tearing off 99% of the stuff you pay the extra money for buying the complete engine, and then just to buy it to replace it anyway. So I didn't need it. I didn't need the harness. I didn't really, I mean, what accessories did I keep? An alternator and a water pump? Like, is a water pump an accessory? I don't know. So, yeah, I regret buying one that was so complete. I didn't need it. I didn't need it to be so complete. So I do regret that. I think that was a waste. I do not regret going LT motor versus LS motor. I think this is going to give us a ton of options here in the near future as technology advances and people really start taking advantage of all the cool stuff an LT motor has over an LS motor. So I don't regret that at all. So we'll be set up later for a 6.2 or whatever. We could put that harness on anything, any of the new Gen 5 stuff. So I don't regret that at all. I do regret going turbo 350 and slip yoke eliminating the 208, all that stuff. I wish I would have just thrown it all in the garbage and put the TR6060 in right now, or from the very beginning, but we were already so committed to doing it. I'm just staying with it because it is going to be quite the conversion to convert it to a 6-speed after we're already set up. I'm probably gonna have to buy new drive lines. We'll probably have to remake a lot of the suspension parts in the back and the center part. The whole truss probably may have to get rebuilt. I don't know. It's a can of worms. It's going to be an upgrade when we go to do the upgrade. It is going to open a can of worms, and I'm not going to count on any of that stuff working for us. So there are some regrets there. A lot of this stemmed from trying to do this as a budget build. The budget build part of it, I think I just, it just didn't make sense to continue down the budget road when we knew we were going to be upgrading the parts later. So why would we spend the money on parts just to replace them in a very short time, you know, to make videos out of it, when we could just be using that money to build another project and getting more viewers for a project of different interest. Well, moving on to axles and stuff, we got the drivetrain part of it out of the way, the engine and transmission out of the way. The Dana 44, I regret a little bit. I wish we would have just done a Super Duty axle from the beginning, but it is what it is. It's going to work. It's a weak link, yes. If we treat it right, no, it's not going to be a weak link. And it is nice because it's fairly light in comparison to a Super Duty axle. So we'll see. We'll see if we fall in love with this axle or not out on the road during the shakedown test. I'm not sure if we're going to like it or if we're going to hate it. I don't know. That limited slip in there is definitely going to test our like-hate ability on this thing. I don't know if that really made sense, even though I made it up. A little bit of regret there, not too much regret.
Okay,
there.
Rear axle 14 bolt,
no regrets. I have zero regrets on this. This is a great axle. We can keep upgrading it as we go. Yeah, no regrets on that. That is going to get painted, put in. Zero regrets. Okay, so moving on to the suspension on the car. So rear suspension. I just need to clean it up, paint it, and start putting it together. I mean, we're there. I don't have anything I need to do yet. The brake lines, everything's going to work back here. So that just needs to be put together. Obviously, this transmission doesn't have a fake slip yoke thing on the back, but the drive lines and stuff, those are all going to work really good. Everything should clear that. Didn't need those again. They do hurt my feelings every time I see them, so I got to fix those. I should fix them so they don't have to stop keep looking at them. So in the back end, no concern. I don't have any concerns other than getting exhaust by. I did not leave myself a lot of options for getting exhaust over the axle, but otherwise I don't have any concerns back there. I think performance wise stuff is going to be great. It should work out for us really, really well. Moving up front, there are some concerns with running 4-link on a long travel suspension car or truck or whatever. And it's why a lot of places people don't put 4-link on a long travel front of a car, that is, especially if you're going to do it for more of a high speed type thing. And I'll tell you why. So why that is. So and that's when you're doing a traditional style steering box. Really, the only option then would be to do a hydraulic steering, complete hydraulic steering, which is not DOT approved, and I wouldn't actually even recommend doing it either. If your engine stalls, you have no steering, that's not a good thing. Unless you do a backup hydraulic pump and stuff, which you can, it can be overcome. It's just, it's not DOT approved no matter how you do it. You have to have mechanical linkage to your steering. So picture this. This is my concern. This is the going to the bump steer thing that we were talking about.
And this is why the steering cylinder helps for bump steer from things hitting the tires and stuff like that. The steering cylinder is going to help not make that happen. That's not the bump steer I'm talking about. The bump steer I'm talking about is when you're, say, going kind of fast and you become really light on the tires or airborne and then land. That's going to jerk the steering wheel right out of your hand. And the reason why that steering cylinder isn't going to help us in this situation, because it's not the fact that the wheels are turning. It's the fact that the steering arm is going from, where is it? Looking through the camera. From the steering arm down to the axle, say when it's drooped completely from being airborne or light, and then compressing. So now all of a sudden, all that additional length that was taken up from being at an angle, now when it comes up, is going to shove that arm that way. Because your forelink kept your axle nice and centered. So now all that downward or upward motion is going to straighten out that bar, and it's going to shove that arm that way. So that's what I mean by bump steer. Not like bump steer as in you hit a rut or something and it jerks the wheel. I mean when your suspension collapses from landing, it's going to shove the wheel that way, and it's going to shove it that way, and that steering cylinder is going to make it so the wheels won't turn. It'll just be pulling out of your hand. I'm not sure how bad that's going to be. So we are. That's why it's a concern, and that's why I haven't addressed it. So the fix to that would be, take one of the four upper forelink arms out, and then make a panhard bar. Because if you take one arm out, the axle can't twist still, but it can float side to side. And then you would put a steering arm that would be as in line with this as possible, going across, so that basically the axle then is swinging in the car with the steering, so that you won't feel the bump steer in the car. But the car, I don't know if you didn't really feel the axle movement side to side. It depends. The longer that arm is, the less movement you'll get side to side. And that's the nice part about us having this big long croc steer. I don't know how bad the bump steer is actually going to be. I may be overly worried about it, but I was already worried about it. And someone commented on an Instagram post of a picture of this car with suspension on it going from the bottom. And they commented, and they're experienced, that my bump steer is going to be terrible. So then it reinstated my concern for my bump steer issue. So there's that. So that's a pretty big concern. But moving on, we're going to have to just deal with it when the time comes for that. And again, we're not using this car competition. So if it's just mildly irritating when you're driving it like that, then that's a lot different than if you're actually racing the rig and having that happen. So that is the suspension. I guess that wraps it up. I obviously have regrets of all the modifications I had to do to this after I built it. And I do regret our towers. I don't like them. I think they're ugly as hell. I think they look stupid, but that's my personal opinion. I wish I would have done a loop, and I wish I would have done the loop tall enough to where the shock mounted from the top side of it. So that is my regret on that, because that caused me a huge headache, and I still have work to do on it. I have to add some more clearance and stuff to it. So I do regret that. I should have done that differently. I've learned my lesson. I won't do that again, I promise. So that's that. All right, so we're kind of in the part of the episode now where it's the wind down part of the episode, but it's going to be a really long-winded wind down, because I'm going to talk about how we're going to get this car done on the down to a shakedown run, and then moving forward with it, future projects of Death Toll, and where we're going to go from here. So to get this car on a shakedown run, basically we're at the point now where I'm just going to strip everything off of it like I was doing before we got in the U-turn project of swapping from from the Pontiac to the LT motor. But we're back to that point. So now we're going to take it out, strip everything down, take everything off of it, start painting and cleaning everything up. Painting all the parts, and we're going to start final assembly. Motor will go back in it. It'll go back in it with the transmission, the real transmission, torque converter, all that stuff, the real transfer case we're using, and all that stuff. So it's going to go final assembly from here on out as far as drivability-wise goes. We still need some seats for our shakedown run. So I'm going to have to make a decision on seats and get them coming. I don't think I'm going to have time to get TMI seats. I would like to, but man, they're usually like at least like 6 weeks out, probably more close to 8 weeks, depending on when you need them. Unless they have some seats that they just stock, I'm not sure. I'll have to see, and then we can just match the back seats to them. But anyway, so that's kind of where we're at on this thing, and that's how we're going to move forward. So that's what I'm going to start working on. Next week we have the tow truck engine manual swap, Phytech, and so you'll start seeing those videos coming out. Hopefully there might be some little videos of Pontiac stuff coming out too. So as for Death Door Racing, we're moving shops and we're moving houses. So this is at my house. We're moving houses. We got 40 acres, which comes with, it's all wooded. So we're going to have a little bit of testing grounds and stuff. I mean, not like racetrack testing grounds, but we can at least take stuff out and climb it. And it is on a hillside. So there will be some hill climbing type terrain. That'll be really cool having that in our backyard. The shop that's on it is 30 by 70, 16 and a half, has a big loft in the back. Really, really cool. I had to pick up Bob. If you don't pick him up, he climbs you or jumps and you have to catch him. I call it the leap of faith, because if you don't catch him, you're the one who gets punished. So it has a big shop on it. It's fully insulated and all that stuff, but it needs obviously a lot of our work and stuff. So there'll be a lot of episodes of doing air system and power upgrades and all that stuff, like shop type stuff. It'll be its own folder. But I'm gonna make videos of it because it's stuff that I've had to research crap out of it. I didn't really know. I didn't have anything to go on. So it'll be useful information for people, so that you don't waste a bunch of money buying stuff that doesn't work right for you. So there'll be a lot of videos like that. And that's it. So future projects for Death Toll are going to be, we got this thing, obviously. This will be kind of a forever project. I don't ever plan on getting rid of it. And as long as people are still interested in this car, we'll keep upgrading it. I have my big orange K5 Blaze that you see sitting outside. I built that thing just after high school. I want to restore it. It has over 400,000 miles on it now. I've taken it, gosh, to probably 30 of the states in the U.S. It's been driven. It was my daily driver for years and years and years, and it's just an awesome, awesome rig. I love it to death, and there's just something about that massive steel that I just love. And it's just, it's always going to be that way to me, and it's always been so good to me. So I'm going to restore it. We're going to semi-restore it. It doesn't need to be restored. It's not in really bad shape, but we're going to upgrade the suspension on it. We're going to repaint it. I got a new soft top for it. And we're just going to do stuff like that. We'll put new seats in it. I actually have a full TMI interior for it that I bought last year, and because I was planning on doing that before this stupid thing came and ruined my life. Just kidding. But anyway, so that's a future plan. I got an old 64 Ford 4x4 F250 that was my grandfather's. I'm gonna put that 429 we got. I'm gonna rebuild another ZF5. We're gonna put that in that. The car is all patinaed and old, and I don't want to change it because it's how I remember it from when I was a kid, and it still looks the same, and it's gonna stay that way. I'm just gonna keep it that way. But I want to put a motor in it, and we'll upgrade the axles on it a little bit, put disc brakes on it and stuff, because it's four-wheel drum right now. We got an old Power Wagon, second gen Power Wagon, a 2.25 ton, really cool looking truck, really unique. You don't see them around that body style. Everyone's familiar with the first ones, and then the later, what they call them, sweep lines. This one's in between. Really odd looking, super cool patina on it, really cool truck. Got it from a friend. Their friend, it was on a family, she must have grown up with it, I assume, but down in Boise, we drug it back a while back, and I'll post some pictures of it on there. Really cool old truck. So we're going to build that in something, maybe like a chase rig or something. So that's coming up. We got a little drag truck that we got that we're going to fix up. I got a old Chevy Caprice that we're going to throw a 302 DZ motor in, a fake one. It's all aftermarket parts. I'm not wasting a real DZ on it. And a 6-speed manual. We got all that stuff, so that's coming in. We got coilovers and all that. And really cool old car. I love it. The BAFTA or boxy, the boxy Caprices. 9C1, so it's push bars and stuff. I have an old Lincoln Continental suicide door that I had I bought that just after high school. You remember the movie The Matrix? Everyone remembers The Matrix. I loved that Lincoln in that movie, in the first Matrix, when they weren't in The Matrix, went back into The Matrix, I guess. That car, so I bought one of those, and it wasn't even the right body style. It was the same Suicide Door body, but it's a 68, early 68. So I want to redo that one a little bit. I used to tow my 67 Camaro on a flatbed trailer with that car back in the day. It was really, really cool. I'll post a picture of that too. We got a lot of projects to do. I got a lot of walkarounds on rigs I already have done that I'd like to do. And stuff like that. We have I got like an old split bumper Camaro we're gonna do at some point. Everything I do isn't a 4x4, and that's a little misleading from this thing. My Akilah has in the paint booth right now, she has an old Camaro. It's a 79 or something. The ones with the plastic bumper, Z28 4-speed, come from a friend who'd had it for a long time. Really, really cool car. It was like a really old build, like from the 90s, but like top of the line parts. And then, it just kind of got old. And we got it, so we're sprucing it back up. It's going Hugger Orange and full TMI interior on that one too. That's all sitting there in boxes. So that's coming up. In fact, it's a Super D10, shifts like butter. And then it has an aluminum headed 350 11-to-1. And it sounds just wicked. The Duntop 2020 cam. Anyway, really, really cool car. So that's going on. That's Akilah's car, and that was Sly's car, one of our friends growing up. So that is that. Thanks for watching. I guess we'll see you next week when it comes time to getting that motor in that tow truck. I'm gonna set this thing down this weekend. I might be able to pop out one more video on this, but it's just gonna be a time lapse of a bunch of stuff getting painted and stuff. I don't think I'm gonna get to assembling before I start on that tow truck. So hang in there. We'll see you next week.